Overview of what we have covered in the last class. So I started by giving you details about some salient or important features of finite element method. So what are the important features? So first, the whatever is the domain of analysis, it is divided into something called elements. Then the approximation functions in finite element method are defined over each element. So for example, in 1D, it is a line element. In 2D, triangular or quadrilateral elements. And in 3D, we define the approximation functions over tetrahedral, wedge and hexahedral elements. Then, so within an element, what we do is we write down the solution in FEM as equal to summation of solution at the nodes multiplied by the corresponding interpolation function. Then once you write down the solution like this and you take the weight functions to be psi ei, then the weak form can be written as in matrix form as ke ue equals to fe in the matrix form. After that, we assemble the matrices, we impose the boundary conditions, and we finally solve for the unknown degrees of freedom in the problem. Fine. So this was something generic about the finite element method. Then we moved on to a specific problem. So we were looking at one-dimensional steady state analysis. We were doing analysis in the domain x ranging from 0 to capital L. The governing differential equation was a second order differential equation, ordinary differential equation. It was minus d by dx of a du by dx plus cu minus f equals to 0 with boundary conditions of u at 0 equal to u naught and a du by dx at L equals to q naught. So this was the problem, a differential equation which has to be satisfied over a certain domain with some boundary conditions. Now to solve this problem, as I had said, first we have to discretize the domain. Means we have to represent the domain as a collection of elements. So here our domain was ranging from x equal to 0 to L, and we are going to subdivide this into capital N number of elements. So these circles which you see, these are called nodes, and what I have marked over here are the end nodes of each element. So if I were to take a two noded element, then I will have n plus one number of total number of nodes, okay? And an element omega e, or if I represent domain of an element e by omega e, the domain goes from xe to xe plus one. And he being the size of the element. Size of the element is defined as xe plus 1 minus xe. Now, once you discretize the domain, then the next step in FEM, the steps are the same. Discretize your domain, then derive the element matrix equations over an arbitrary element domain. So for that, we have to evaluate the weak form over element domain omega e. So to get the weak form, first we write down the weighted integral statement, which is integral over the domain of weight function multiplied by the residual into dx equals to 0. Then we have to take integration by parts, we get this, and after that we substitute the boundary condition. Over here, the incoming fluxes at both ends are denoted by QE1 and QE2, and then by taking this minus adu by dx at xe to be qe1, adu by dx at xe plus 1 to be qe2, the weak form statement becomes this. After this, we write down u as equal to ue as equal to summation uej psi ej and w as equal to psi ei, where uej are values of u at nodes and psi ej are corresponding interpolation functions. Once we make this substitution, then, and if we denote keij as be of psi ei comma psi ej, fei as integral of integral over the domain of w into psi ei dx and q ei as this, then the element weak form statement becomes this. Okay, we get this element matrix equation. Now, for the properties of the interpolation functions, I had said that this statement has to be always valid within an element. And so now if we evaluate UE at the nodes, then we find that UEI must be equal to this. And based on this, we had shown that the interpolation function would have a value 1 at the corresponding node and 0 at the other nodes. So if I take psi e 1, it will have value 1 at local node 1 and 0 at all the other local nodes. So based on this definition, for n equals to 2 and n equals to 3, we had plotted the interpolation functions and we had plotted the interpolation functions. And for the assembly, I had said that if you take a node which is shared by the two elements, and if you take infinitesimal element length across this particular node, then you can show that QE minus 1 2 plus QE 1 should be equal to capital QE, where QE is the external force or heat input at the global node I equals to E. So based on this, by adding appropriate rows in element matrices E minus 1 and E, we get this equation, which is basically a conservation statement for global node I. So like this, we get one equation for each global node, and finally we end up with whatever are the total number of global nodes, we end up with that many number of equations and that many number of unknowns, and we have to solve for the unknowns. This is what I have covered in the last class. Any questions until here? Okay, you are able to hear me, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So yes, sir. Let me move on to the today's notes. All right. So, as we have seen, one of the things that we have to start with before we start solving an FEM problem is we have to derive the element matrices for an arbitrary element domain. So here, that's the first thing that we are going to do. We will start with the case where small n, meaning number of nodes per element, is 2. Element matrices have to be derived separately for different orders of interpolation. Okay, so for n equals to 2, when we have 2 nodes per element, what is the order of interpolation for the solution within the element? How does solution vary within the element if we consider 2 local nodes per element?
Linear.
So the solution varies linearly if we are going to assume 2 nodes per element. Okay. So these are the definitions for KEIJ and FEI, and this is what we have to evaluate. Okay. So now, what will be the interpolation functions? So first thing that we do is we define a local coordinate X bar. Okay. X bar is defined as X minus XE by XE plus 1 minus XE. Now, so what will be the value of X bar at local node 1?
0,
right? Because local node 1 corresponds to X equals to XE. And what will be the value of X bar for local node 2?
1.
It will be 1, because at local node 2, we have X equal to XE plus 1. So we choose a local coordinate such that within the element, this local coordinate goes from 0 to 1. Integration is actually simpler with this. So now, what will be psi e1 in terms of this local coordinate x bar. So what do we know about psi e1?
So that should be present at e at one node and it should be 0 at 2.
So at local node 1 it should have value 1 and local node 2 it should have value 0. So what will be the function? So psi e1 will simply be equal to 1 minus x bar. Okay, so it's a linear function with the root of the function at x bar equals to 1. What do you understand by roots of a polynomial?
The values of x at which the function is equal to 0.
So if it's a function of x, then roots are basically the values of x at which the function is 0. Now in this case, we know that for psi e1, it should be 0 at local node 2, and for psi e2, it should be 0 at local node 1. So for psi e1, the root is 1, so we can write the function as 1 minus x bar. So then at x bar equal to 0, it has value 1, and at x bar equal to 1, it has value 0. And what will be psi e2? It would simply be x bar, because at local node 1 psi e2 must be 0 and local node 2 psi e2 must be 1. So the interpolation functions for two noded line elements will simply be 1 minus x bar and x bar. So now once you know these things, what do you think is the best way to evaluate KEIJ and FEI?
Sir.
What
is that x bar, sir?
X bar is a local coordinate. See, in maths, whenever you are doing differentiation, integration, change of variables is something that we keep doing, right? We do change of variables so that our effort reduces. Here, what I am doing is I am introducing a new variable called X bar, which I am calling as a local coordinate, meaning it is something defined for element E. So X bar is defined in such a manner that as x goes from xe to xe plus 1, x bar goes from 0 to 1. So instead of defining psi 1 and psi 2 instead of as a function of x, I'm going to define it as a function of x bar. Okay, I'm just doing a change of coordinates. Now so can you tell me what will be the best method of evaluating KE and FE? We have to do this integration, okay? What do you suggest we do?
Write a mathematical code.
So we can write a simple mathematical code, okay? Now, before I go to the mathematical code, let me also look at the matrix equations for n equals to 3, okay? So for n equals, so to do the integration, we have to say something about A, C and F, which in general can be a function of X. But for now, what we will do is we will assume that they are constant within the element. Okay, it's not a bad assumption. So even if material properties or load or anything change within the domain, you can assume them to be constant within the element if your mesh is fine enough. Okay. So here we will take them to be constant within the element. So we will say that, okay, A equals to AE, F equals to FE and C equals to CE in omega E. So now, if I do change of variables, what will happen to the integration? So if I am going to write my integrand in terms of X bar, what will be the domain of integration now?
0 to 1.
Okay, so when I do change of coordinates from x to x bar, my domain of integration changes from xe to xe plus 1 to 0 to 1. Okay, now when you have a derivative, originally you had a derivative with respect to x, right? So you had a d psi ei by dx. But now we are writing psi ei in terms of x bar. So how should you rewrite this? So we rewrite this as we use chain rule. So d psi ei by dx, we write it as d psi ei by dx bar into dx bar by dx. Similarly, d psi ej by dx, we write it as d psi ej by dx bar into dx bar by dx. So this gives me into dx bar whole square. This term is unaffected. And what happens to dx? Dx, I can write it as dx by dx bar into dx bar. So my integral, I can rewrite it like this. And FEI, I can rewrite it like this. Now, what is dx bar by dx? X bar is x minus xc by he, right? So dx bar by dx will simply be 1 by he, okay? So this is how we rewrite this KEIJ and FEI equations. Now, if we go to n equals to 3, okay? If we go to n equals to 3, okay, I haven't written over here. What will be psi 1, anybody? For n equals to 3, what will be the first interpolation function? What are its roots?
X minus x2 into x minus x3 by x1 minus x2 into x2 minus x1 minus x3.
No. First tell me, what will be the roots in terms of x bar? So, if small n equals to 3, for psi 1, what will be psi 1? Will it be linear, quadratic, cubic? What will it be?
Quadratic.
It will be quadratic polynomial. Okay. So if it's a quadratic polynomial in x as well as quadratic polynomial in x bar, then what will be the roots of the polynomial when we write it in terms of x bar?
0.10. X2 and x3.
It will be xc2 and xc3. Now, if we take the three nodes at x bar equal to 0, x bar equal to half, and x bar equals to 1, then what will be the roots of the polynomial for interpolation function psi 1?
Half and 1.
So what should be the form of the polynomial?
X minus half into x bar minus half
whole multiplied by x bar minus 1 into some constant, okay? Because those are the two roots. Now, how will you get that constant?
Integrate and normalize.
No integration. At x bar equal to 0, what should be the function value?
1.
It should be 1. So, based on that information, you get your constant. So, like that, you can determine the other two interpolation functions too. So now let us move to Mathematica and see how we evaluate these matrices, okay? I will stop the video and restart it again.